My pranams to all Atma Jyotis, divine light of the self. Today, the topic is the process of Jnana or Jnana Yoga. Let us understand why Jnana Yoga is important and how Jnana Yoga takes us to the highest realization, the peak of human life in the form of Atma Jnana. First, let us understand, all of us, we try various spiritual practices, the sadhanas. Why are we doing that? What is the purpose? What are we trying to seek? What is the urginess? Why are we going after spiritual practices? Any answers? Happiness? Peace of mind? All of us are seeking happiness and peace of mind. So this happiness and peace of mind, the urge for happiness and peace of mind, is driving us, driving our search for seeking something which will give us happiness and peace. Many times we find some happiness and peace in life, right? I do something and be happy with that. I get something, I'll be peaceful with that. But every time when you get something, when you do something and get happiness, the peace and happiness seem to be temporary. It just skips away. It is momentary. It doesn't stay. In no time, it just disappears. Somebody is happy when he gets a good job. Very happy. But before he realizes, already unhappiness has set in. He starts looking for what you call as promotion. And he gets a promotion, somebody else gets a better salary, he is unhappy. So this happiness, the whole of life is search for a sort of happiness and peace. And sooner or later we realize that all attempts to get happiness which is permanent or peace which is permanent is futile. There's no way you can get it. Okay? Whatever you do, you cannot get it. Then we start looking for a path of spiritual path, so-called spiritual path, where somebody has told us the spirituality gives you happiness and peace. And we do various kinds of practices, right? Starting from chanting, going to yatras, going to some healing practices, then karma healing, okay, past life regression. Many times of practices we try to do. Somewhere we want to get rid of the misery called so-called misery, okay, which keeps us constantly seeking for happiness. Various kinds of practices you try. There's no end to list of practices. In fact, India is a country which is a supermarket for spiritual practices. It's a mall. You ask anything, it is there. You ask this practice, it is there. You say, I want this practice, it is there. That is reflected in our Kumbh Mela, which happens in once in 6 years, 12 years, Prayagraj, now it's going on, right? Everywhere in the world, there is a festival, okay, some sales are there, some religious festivals are there, some goodies are there, okay, some vehicle sales are there, lot of people gather. But nowhere in the world, there is a festival or there is a gathering which seeks enlightenment, right? Everybody comes there in the hope of enlightenment. Everybody. And all types of practices. Okay, there is somebody who is naked, to somebody who's adorned in gold jewels, somebody who doesn't have a single possession, to somebody with a mobile phone and car, somebody coming on the elephant. People come from all walks of life seeking for enlightenment. Nowhere in the world so many people gather with a single desire for enlightenment. And you see the variety of practices there, all types of practices. Okay? The type of practices which you get in this country are innumerable. Depending on your taste, depending on your flavor, everything is available. So I would say India is a supermarket for spirituality or enlightenment. Now the question comes, what do I choose? What is that I want to, which is suitable for me? Okay. What gives me what I am seeking? The peace and happiness. Initially we don't know, right? We keep on trying something. Somebody told me something, I'll try that. Somebody told me, I'll try something that. Lot of experimentation goes on. And somewhere we are not satisfied. Somewhere the urge for peace, urge for happiness is not satisfied. This urge for peace and happiness is another name for that is called enlightenment. Okay. Why it doesn't get satisfied? We don't know. Where is the answer? We don't know. Then we go for guru hunting or search for gurus. One ashram to other ashram, one ashram to other ashram, one place to other place, one practice to other practice, one festival to other festival. We keep on hopping in the hope that somewhere something clicks. Doesn't work that way. Why is that so? So this is because it is said that the eternal peace you can get only when you know yourself, Atmajnana. It is through the knowledge of self you are liberated. Nothing else can help you. No practices can help you. I mean, of course, they can help you to bring some amount of mental clarity and peace. But they cannot give you total freedom which you are seeking. Total freedom and peace. Because that's your nature. So in other words, your spiritual journey is a seeking for happiness. Seeking for peace. What kind of peace and happiness? The eternal peace. The eternal happiness. The peace that surpasseth. The peace beyond all pieces. That's called that's what is said in the Bible. Peace that surpasseth. The peace which goes beyond all the pieces. The supreme peace. It's called Parashanti. That is somewhere missing. So this search for supreme peace is called search for enlightenment or Jivan Mukti. The enlightenment or Jivan Mukti is this. The craving, the desire for peace, the eternal peace, the supreme peace, is the desire for that is called the desire for mukti. It's also called mumukshatva or desire for liberation. The desire for liberation cannot be satisfied through any action. Okay? No action can give you the supreme bliss and peace, because every action is in the transactional domain and every transaction has a limited result. No transaction gives an unlimited result. Everything what you do in life can give only limited result, right? If you put one tree, one mango seed, one tree will come. You cannot get infinite mangoes If you put 10 trees, it will give 10. No, I want infinity, it doesn't work. Now what you are looking for is infinite peace with a finite limited action. No matter how hard you try, you will not get it. No amount of chanting, no amount of reading, no amount of actions can lead you to the infinite bliss, eternal bliss, eternal peace which you are seeking. So your desire starts for happiness, peace, permanent happiness, permanent peace, which is called mumukshatva, or desire for liberation or enlightenment. And for that enlightenment, actions can give only limited result. They cannot give the result which you are seeking, which is eternal peace. What is the way out? So it is said, nahi jnanena sadrisham pavitramiha udyate. Nothing purifies like jnana. Nothing is more purifying than jnana. Jnana alone can help you to purify. So then, but we tried all sorts of practices to purify myself, to purify my inner self. I did chanting, I did a sort of a past life regression, I read confessions. So all sorts of things I have tried, but nothing can empty out my mess which is there inside. Okay? Because all these are finite actions. Finite actions cannot lead to the infinite. No amount of finite actions can lead to infinite. That's why it said, nahi jnanen sadrisham pavitram yude. Nothing is more purifying than jnana. I want to purify my subconscious. I want to purify my antakarana. Do you know how much is there in that? Okay, what is stored in that? How much you will purify? What is the depth of that? How many lifetimes is stored there? Can we understand what is there and what effort you will put to purify all those things, empty all those things? The only thing which is possible is called Atmajnana or self-knowledge. So desire for peace and happiness leads to desire for enlightenment. Enlightenment desire can only be fulfilled through jnana, knowledge. Okay. So now, what kind of knowledge is this? There are so many subjects: the physics, chemistry, biology, mathematics, psychology, many subjects are there. All these subjects are knowledge. Okay. If jnana is liberating, jnana makes peaceful, a person with 2 PhD should be a very peaceful person. In fact, there is no more, he is very restless. He is trying for his 3rd PhD. Right? A Nobel laureate must be very peaceful because jnana can lead to peace. Jnana is purifying. Nobel laureate is not peaceful. So this jnana is what we are speaking of is not jnana of the world. It is not about the objects of the world or subjects in the world. So jnana is about yourself, myself. Jnana is about my own inner self or my own nature. Where do you find that? Psychologist is supposed to study you and tell what is the problem you are having and giving the solution. But psychologist is studying your mind. It is not about yourself. Is there a subject which teaches me about myself? And that subject is called Vedanta. There is no other subject which can teach you about your own self. Knowledge of myself liberates me. Knowledge of myself frees me. That's why it said, Nahidnanena sadrisham pavitramitya udyate. Knowledge alone can free you, knowledge alone can give you peace, eternal peace. So only subject which can give you the eternal peace is called Vedanta. Now this Vedanta is a very, very peculiar word. It's called Vedanta. The end of knowledge. Knowledge which ends all the knowledge. Right? Every knowledge in the world we are seeking to get some amount of power, because knowledge is power. Whether it's religious or social, right? Knowledge we are seeking in one way or the other way to get some power. Why are you chanting that? Because I want some good to happen to me. Some power and some benefit I am trying to get. That's called knowledge. Okay? Is there something which can end your knowledge? Where you don't no longer search for any knowledge, whether spiritual or religious or secular? Only if that knowledge can give peace, eternal peace. That knowledge alone will stop your search for any more knowledge. That's why it's called Vedanta, end of knowledge, the end. Okay? So, seeking peace will lead you to seeking enlightenment. Seeking enlightenment leads to seeking the knowledge of the self, which is Vedanta. Why Vedanta? Why how does Vedanta solve my problem? Because my problem is, I am restless and not happy. This restlessness, not happiness, I'm not happy, comes from my experience of life. I am a small individual limited to this body-mind complex, competing for every damn thing on the world. The world is so big, everybody is competing against me. When I go to school, okay, there are in my school classmate, there are 40 children who are competing against me to get that first position or second position. High school, 5 lakh people. College, 2 lakh people. Job, 1,000 people. Everywhere there is a competition. I am an individual, I am small, I am trying to survive. Limited. There is a feeling of limitation in me. Okay. I am limited by physical structure. I am limited in knowledge. I can't know a lot of things. This is called Deha Bandha. The body wise I am limited. The body goes through aging, I feel sufferable, I am suffering. The body goes through pain, I am suffering. The body, someday I die. So whatever I have earned and everything goes away, there is a fear. The limitation of body makes me feel suffering, cause suffering to me. Knowledge wise, very little knowledge. Whatever knowledge I can gain, some 13 or 15 years of schooling, is that's all I can have. Knowledge is power. Where is power for me? I am very limited knowledge. Even with engineering degree or PhD, my knowledge is limited. I have limited knowledge. Jnana bandha, deha bandha. Then karma bandha. I do something and the result will come. People say, scriptures say, that your karma will come back to you. I don't know how much karma I have done, how many lifetimes. And I don't know how many lifetimes I have to experience that. So karma bandha, jnana bandha, deha bandha. Okay. All these limitations are there. And of course, I go through the mood swings. The happiness, sorrow, the joy, suffering. Everything I am going through. There is a suffering in me because of Deha Bandha, Jnana Bandha, Karma Bandha. Okay? This is coming because I identify with the body, I identify with my mind, I identify with my intellect, and I identify with my karma, actions. I am the body, I am the mind, I am the intellect, I am the doer, I am the enjoyer, I am the knower. All sorts of limitations are there. And these limitations is what makes me unhappy. Can I get rid of these limitations? So the teaching of Vedanta is, yes, you can get rid of them by knowing yourself. Right now, you don't know yourself. So, no, I know about myself. What do you know about myself? I am so and so, I am so and so. See, these are all, whatever you call as yourself, is nothing but a social interaction. I am a husband with reference to wife. I am a mother, I am a father with reference to my son. I am an engineer with reference to my job. So all social interactions I consider as myself, which is not. Yourself is something which is beyond this. Yourself is infinite. Yourself is of nature of eternal peace, eternal bliss. So recognize that self. It is non-dual. Oh, I am infinite. Okay, my competitor, no, he's also infinite. So we have a competition between two infinities. Then what will happen to me? Then I'll start suffering. If I am infinite, I feel powerful. Yeah, but everybody in the world is so. Okay, so then what will happen to me? Again, I'm back to same state. It's not like that. That infinity is only one. That infinity, that eternal self I am, and I alone is the reality. I am alone is the reality. What about the others? Yourself is the other self also. What about God? If people don't have trouble me, the God may be angry with me. The self of you is the self of God also. So there's no two selves. There's only one self, which is non-dual, which is eternal, which is peaceful, which is blissful, which is infinite, and I am that. This is the teaching of Vedanta. Now the question comes, how do we get the teaching? Right? The teaching seems to be very nice, very interesting. How do I get the teaching? For getting the teaching, you have to go to a master. Who he is himself who has realized that. Who himself has become peaceful, blissful, who has recognized his own self as eternal, supreme reality. And such a master is called an enlightened one, a realized one, or Brahmajnani. They are called by various names. Our problem will not get solved if I don't find such a master. Because he himself is searching for happiness and peace. Many times he starts searching for happiness and peace through you. So, the happiness and peace which you are looking for, you can get only somebody who is happy and peaceful. No, he himself. A blind person cannot lead another blind person. At least somebody with eyes is required. So you need to find an enlightened master, a realized master, or a competent master, who is that, which can give you, who can give the wisdom to you. Such a person is called a Jnani, a Brahmanishta, or enlightened one. Many names are there. See the process now. You started seeking happiness, peace, and you tried every damn thing on the earth. Getting a job, getting marriage, doing XYZ, doing all things, even to getting your name in the Guinness Book of World Record. So nothing seems to be working. So now you say it's a permanent peace and happiness I am looked for. Then that is called enlightenment. So that enlightenment means can come through only Jnana. So Jnana can come through only master. And what master can give? Master cannot manufacture Jnana. The knowledge cannot be manufactured. So one day a scientist will come and say, I discovered a new planet, I discovered new theory. Jnana is not a new theory. Okay, Jnana cannot, nobody can discover tomorrow something new in Jnana about the self. Okay, about the self, Jnana is ancient, most ancient. 10,000 years back also human beings had same problem. Now also they have same problem. In future also they have same problem. Whatever technology you have doesn't make any difference in human life. The quality of human life, the inner suffering. The Jnana which has to come in the form of Vedanta, and the source of Vedanta is an enlightened mind or not human mind. The human mind has not conceptualized enlightenment. Okay? Why this is important? Because the Vedanta is teaching you, you are the consciousness, you are the supreme reality. Then you will ask, is there any hidden agenda in this? Who doesn't tell you are smart and beautiful? Your boss will come and pat your back and say, you're the smartest guy in the job, because he wants to make you run harder, run faster, do more work. Your husband will say, oh, you look very nice today. Okay? Your wife will say, smile at husband and praise him. Everybody is praising everybody else to get some benefit. Right? Psychologist you go, okay? They will say, think positively, act positively. Right? Whatever you think, you become. So there are a lot of motivational talk goes on. And now we have become skeptical of all motivation talks. Because there is somewhere the hidden agenda is there. Okay? Is this a motivational talk that you are the self? You are the supreme reality? You are the bliss? You are Brahma? Is this another motivational talk which makes me feel better, good? Yeah, anything which says me I am good, yeah, it makes me feel good. Is it another feel good talk? It is not another feel good talk, because it is not done by a person who has some vested interest in himself or the society. So it's a Vedanta teaching, we say, it has not come from a human origin. It means a mind, it's not a human creation, it is the gift from the supreme reality, divinity has come to human being. So this basic belief you have to have. Okay? You have to believe that Vedanta teaches the reality, truth. If you don't have belief of that, then you can't, this enlightenment search will not take you anywhere. Enlightenment search will take you to many ashrams, Himalayas, but it will not take you to the real enlightenment. You should have a trust that, yeah, there is something called Vedanta, there is a belief that something called Vedanta, which is the supreme truth. Many masters in India, from time immemorial, have relied on Vedanta to understand the truths and make their life better and help people. So it has an authenticity. This you have to accept. If you don't have this trust and faith in Vedanta, this is not the path for you. You find some other path. Okay? Is that clear? Then you should have a master who can teach you what is there in Vedanta in a way you can understand. Ultimately, there's a physics textbook, the chemistry textbook. Why the teacher is required? The textbook is sufficient now. The textbook gives the information, but that information has to be communicated to you in the way you can understand. That's the role of a teacher. Okay? So a Brahmanista or a Jnani should be able to communicate the truths of Vedanta to you in a way you can understand. Right? And this teaching ability is called Shrotriya. A person may be a Jnani, a realized person, but if he doesn't have the teaching ability, you will not get that. You feel peaceful in his presence, you feel happy in his presence, but you cannot understand what is that I need to do to get what peace you have. So somebody should be able to explain the mechanism of peace How do I get peace? Mechanism of the jnana, he has to understand in a language which is simple enough for you to understand. So that is the role of a master. The master, first, he himself should have peace. He should be blissful. He should have realized his self. And he should be able to communicate. If he has not done that, then his communication will be mismatched. He can only explain something is there in scripture, give a literal meaning, a dictionary meaning, or a logical meaning, but that power of communication is missing. It is not the communication we are looking for, it is the communion we are looking for. Communication is the words, communion is the presence of the master, okay? The presence of the peace from the master, he has realized. And his words of communication brings that communion. It's no longer words, but the inner opening which happens in the presence of the master. So, seeking peace, step number one. Seeking eternal peace, called enlightenment. Seeking jnana for that. Seeking for master for that. And the subject matter of the Vedanta is, subject matter of self is Vedanta. Vedanta only deals with yourself. It doesn't deal how to handle your husband, self-improvement, okay? When you are worried, how to reduce your worry, all those topics are not the subject matter of Vedanta. It's only about your self. So you have come up to this point. The Vedanta is the solution. The master shows the way. Up to this point you have come. So now why Vedanta and master? Because if I have to learn some subject, let us say I want to learn chemistry. I need to enroll into a college, okay, which teaches me chemistry. I learn the subject of chemistry. So what is the importance of college? College has a systematic way of giving education. Okay? There's a means of education to be available. The means of education is called pramanam. So the Vedanta and master provided pramanam. Okay? So anything which you know, which you have to listen, that should be authenticity. The Vedanta brings the authenticity, the master brings the authenticity by his presence, by his communication. This authenticity gives a confidence. So this is what is required for jnana. Now whether you absorb that jnana, I don't know. Whether you are able to receive that jnana, for receiving, being able to receive jnana, there are some qualifications are there. Right? Not everybody can learn chemistry or biology or physics or mathematics. Some basic qualifications are there. The basic qualifications we will not discuss. There are some basic qualifications, right? For getting a jnana. Assuming that you have a basic qualification, you come to a master and scripture. Now the master will explain to you, this is the truth. And what does it say? He says, Tat Thomas, you are that. What is you? Whatever you think you are. And that is consciousness, the supreme reality, Brahman. You are that. You are not what you think you are. What you think you are is based on the societal conditioning. What you think you are is based on the religious conditioning. What you think you are based on the family conditioning. Okay? Drop this conditioning and recognize your own true nature as that supreme reality, the self, that Brahman. This is the teaching master will give. The teaching has to be heard, Shravana. Why is Shravana important? Because knowledge of the objects I can get through sense organs. But knowledge of self about you, about myself, I cannot get through sense organs. Sense organs are the instruments, including the ear. what I am, I cannot gather through any sense organs. I have to gather through hearing. That's called Shravana. In the presence of the master, Shravana happens. Master will try to explain who you are through a technique or teaching methodology. It's called Yukti or a Prakriya. A methodology of teaching, it changes from master to master. That's the skill of the master. So sometimes the skills, this teaching methodology comes from generations. From master to disciple, the teaching technique can come. The teaching methodology can come. The teaching logic can come. Or some master may develop his own teaching methodology, but all will be in accordance with the Vedantic knowledge and inner experience. This teaching methodology is called Yukti or a Prakriya. So the idea of Prakriya is to remove the ignorance of your own nature. To understand, I am not the body, I am not the mind, I am not the intellect, I am pure consciousness. Nanu. Nanembudu. Nanalla. Ideha. Mana buddhi. Nanalla. Sachidanandatma. Shivanamnani. Shivanamnani. Shivoham. 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 I am not body, mind or intellect. The body, mind, intellect are instruments of me, but I am not that. I am pure consciousness. I am bliss. This understanding has to come. And the master gives this teaching in various techniques, the methods. It's called Shravana. So now you will come back and say, I have understood all the scriptures. I have a very good intellectual understanding of scriptures. I have a very good intellectual understanding. You name the scripture, I know. I have learned from competent masters also. I have very good intellectual understanding. But I don't have experience. So, now where am I? My dear friends, Atmajnana is intellectual knowledge only. It is not kidney knowledge or liver knowledge or heart knowledge. Intellectual knowledge only is called Atmajnana. Because ignorance is there only in the intellect. I am the body, I am the mind, I am the intellect. Concept is there in the intellect only. That concept has to be dropped. I am the self concept has to come. So no other organs of the body can have knowledge. Only intellect can have. So Atmajnana is purely intellectual knowledge. Now if you think that any other knowledge is there, no. Some supernatural knowledge, some fifth dimension, sixth dimension. There's no such knowledge. The knowledge which is arising purely out of Shravana with a clarity is called Atmajnana. If you start thinking that, oh, something else will happen, you are missing the point. Jnana is intellectual. Because Ajnana is also intellectual. Wrong understanding about myself is also intellectual. This wrong understanding of myself is called Ahankara, ego. It's not the ego English word. Ahankara is feeling of I am. It's a feeling of individuality. Okay? So now, the individuality called Ahankara is riding on intellect called Buddhi and making you operate in life. The Ahankara, ego or Aham, it attaches itself to the body, mind, intellect, says, I am so and so, I am this body, I am this mind, I am the intellect. Okay? It has forgotten who am I, the real self. So it has taken the body, mind, and intellect as myself. It has created a I, me, and mine. Okay? I, me, and mine becomes my identity. And this fellow who is creating that I, me, mine identity is called Ahankar. Okay? So the mind has four functions called Antakarana. Buddhi means intellect. Ahankara means the feeling of I amness. Chitta means memory. Manas means the controller of sense organs to interface with the world. Manas, Buddhi, Ahankara, Chitta. So these four together is called mind. Now out of these, the cause of your trouble is not Buddhi. Not the intellect is not the cause of the trouble. Who is the cause of the trouble? Only two guys, called Ahankara and Chitta. The feeling of I amness and memory is causing the suffering in our life. Only two people, two guys. So when intellect has to take it, intellect is the decision maker. Actually, intellect is the highest. Intellect is the decision maker in the body, it's the boss. But Ahankara rides on the boss and says, do this, don't do this. Okay? So all desires, all actions of the intellect, all decisions of the intellect are influenced by Ahankara, ego. So this Ahankara, Buddhi or intellect is supposed to be the master of our body-mind complex. That master itself is taken over by something called Ahankara, ego. And it dictates all your actions in life. It all dictates all decisions in life. And this Ahankara can never be satisfied because it is arising out of a feeling of limitation of the body, mind and intellect. Okay. So how does Jnana help you? Jnana brings in a discrimination in the intellect, a clarity in the intellect, which will help you to understand the influence of Ahankara in my life, how Ahankara or ego is influencing my life. Ahankara is telling me I am the body and mind intellect, whereas real I is the Atma, the self. So now the what you call as the defection happens. In the election, political parties, they do the defection, no? So intellect makes a defection from Ahankara to the self. It starts working under the influence of the self. The influence of Ahankara becomes weaker and weaker. Finally, the Ahankara disappears. So the intellect is working directly under the guidance of the self. The self is pure consciousness, it's a witness. It's not a doer. It has no agenda of its own. The ego or Ahankara has agenda of its own. The self is the witness, the sakshi, which is blissful. It has no agenda to get something out of you. So intellect starts aligning with the self rather than with the Ahankara. Okay. And how does it happen? This happens by a trained intellect. The intellect is, right now the intellect is trained by the society, very much dominated and trained by your husband and wife, or boss, do this and don't do this. Okay, entire conditioning has gone into intellect and that has gone to ego and memory. The deconditioning has to happen to understand who am I. And this who am I is called Viveka. The discrimination has to come. And the discrimination can only be taught to the intellect. What is the discrimination? Who am I and who am I not? It's called Viveka. This is called Atma, Anatma Viveka has to be taught to the intellect very clearly. So the intellect should be able to apply that again and again. And this is what happens when the master gives you Shravana. The master teaches you the method of discrimination to discriminate Atma and Anatma. He is giving a method to you. It's a formula to you. Atma, Anatma, Viveka. Now whether you apply the formula or you don't apply the formula, I can't say. But ultimately, he tells you boss, you are the intellect is the boss. Now you are getting misguided by the ahankara. You use this discrimination method to find out who you are. Atma, anatma, viveka. You have to apply that logic consistently. Okay? This atma, anatma, viveka comes from again Vedanta teaching. It's called discrimination or viveka. The another discrimination is there called nitya, anitya, viveka. You have to find out what is eternal, what is non-eternal. These two logics you consistently apply in your decision making in your life. You start tuning yourself to the sakshi, the witness, rather than to the ego, ahankara. So this is the teaching which comes from Master Shravana. Right? So that's how Master teaches you, tattvamasi, you are that. You are consciousness, now you are getting influenced by the ego. So this is the method by which you can get out of the influence of ego, deconditioning process. This is the way how to escape the jail. The formula to escape the jail is called discrimination.
Sir, how does it fit anatma in this atma, anatma? What is anatma?
Yeah, his question is the two discriminations.